The topic of Umar radiallahu ta'ala, in reality, most of you know almost everything about Umar radiallahu ta'ala. Yes or no? Yes, insha'Allah. Jayid. So I sat in that hotel room, I thought to myself, now what do we talk about Umar? Maybe let's take this talk in a different angle. Let's take it the A to Z of Umar radiallahu ta'ala. The A to Z of Umar ibn al-Khattab. Jayid. So if, for example, we said the letter A, Jayid. A stands for what? In terms of Umar radiallahu ta'ala, in terms of the life of Umar radiallahu ta'ala, A could be for age. What was the age of Umar radiallahu ta'ala when he passed away? You tell me. What was his age when he passed away?
62.
What's your name, Sheikh? Ibrahim. Ibrahim, what was his age when he passed away, Ibrahim?
63.
He was 63. Excellent. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Jibran, when he passed away, what was his age? His age was also 63. Excellent. Abu Bakr, when he passed away, what was his age? He was also 63. Umar, when he passed away, he was 63. Jayid. And Ali, radiallahu ta'ala, as per many narrations, when he passed away, he was also 63, as per some narrations. Aisha, radiallahu ta'ala, 100% she was 63. So what's the rule then? The sunnah, inshallah, to pass away when you are 63. No, don't say Ameen, Yamashad. Don't say Ameen, Jayid. Rather, you live long life, alhamdulillah, longer than 63, it's better. But the average age span of this ummah is what? Is in the 60s, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Jayid. Hayyakum Allah. What was his age when he became a Muslim? Umar radiallahu ta'ala became Muslim at what age? Imam Asyuti states that at the age of 27, Jayid. How many of you are under 27? Now, age is only but a number, isn't it? Now, so my Mashayikh, you subhanAllah have a head start over Umar radiallahu ta'ala. We're coming here, we're sitting in this weekend, we had the Al-Ghawthar course, we spoke about Uthman, we spoke about Ali, we spoke about Hassan radiallahu ta'ala. They left behind a legacy that people in the year 2012 sit and talk about them. What about yourselves? You have a head start over Umar. He only started his legacy at the age of 27. You have a head start, you're 25, you're 24, what legacy would you leave behind? Would there be someone to talk about you 20 years after you pass away? You know yourselves. Your grandfather passed away, you went to the graveyard, maybe for a week you went to the graveyard, 2 weeks you went to the graveyard, after that class, you cried a few tears here and there, a week went, 2 weeks went, a month went, subhanAllah, and then now what happens? You visit the graveyard maybe once a year. And then it comes the day of Eid, and some say, let's go to the graveyard. But you say, no, I read this hadith, or I read this fatwa or something. You know, day of Eid, don't go to the graveyard. It's a happy day. Don't start it out on a sad day. But then what happens? You don't even go to the graveyard at all. Full stop, subhanAllah. That's reality, yes or no? We are insan, and we forget. The root of insan is what? Mankind. Insan, the root of insan is what? Is nisyan. Nisyan means to? To forget. Nasiya Adam wa nasiya dhurriyatahu. Adam forgot and his children also forgot. What did Adam forget? Not to go close to the tree. No, he did that purposefully, Shaykh. If that was forgetfulness, then we'd all still be in Jannah, inshallah. Shaykh, Rabbana la tu'akhidna in nasina aw akhtana. Well, don't hold us accountable for that which we forgot. If Adam ate of the tree due to forgetfulness, then it wouldn't have been a sin, yes or no? It wouldn't have been a sin. But rather, he did that purposefully, deliberately. Shaitan said to him, that eat of the tree and you will have mulk, la yabla. You will have a kingdom which will not come to an end. Rather, what did Adam forget? Follow the Torah.
Is it that he forgot that he gave Dawud al-Islam 40 years of his life?
Excellent, the Torah. He gave Dawud al-Islam 40 years of his life. And then later on, when the angel of death came to take his life, he says, no, but I still got 40 years left. Angel of death said, no. You remember, you know, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took out all the progeny, your progeny, etc. And you looked and you saw one was like shining, sparkling. And you asked, who is this? This was Dawood. And you asked, how long would he live? And he lived for such a number of years. And then you said, well, give him 40 years from my life. See, this is what Adam forgot. Nasiya Adam forgot, and his children also forget. So in sign, we forget, subhanAllah, grandfather passed away, mother passed away, whoever it might be, maybe it's a blessing that we actually forget. Otherwise, If we had to ponder over death all the time, what type of life would we live? We wouldn't go to study, we wouldn't start businesses, we won't, because we'd be consumed with the idea of death. So maybe in reality, it's a ni'mah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hayyakum Allah. Insan also, side story, another root of insan is uns. Uns means, you know, companionship. You have the name Anisa, you have the guy whose name is Anis. So insan either comes from nisyan, which means to forget, or it comes from uns, which is companionship. Because we as human beings, we always need companionship. We can't just live on a mountain for 20, 30, 40 years, etc. So ya mashayikh, which is the plural of Shaykh Jayid, because you're all rich, inshallah. Umar radiallahu ta'ala, he became a Muslim at the age of 27. He died at the age of 63. And he was born 13 years before the year of the 13 years after the, what do you call it, year of the elephant. Who was born in the year of the elephant? Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That year when Abraha came with his elephants to destroy the Kaaba, etc., he was unsuccessful. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam born in that year. And then 13 years after this, Umar was born. So it shows that Umar, number one, was younger than the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by about 13 years. He was also younger than Abu Bakr. He was also younger than Uthman radiallahu ta'ala an jayyid. Ali was younger than Umar radiallahu ta'ala an jayyid. So that was A. A was for age. Age was 27 when he became a Muslim. B is for what? B is for battles. He was there next to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with every single battle. We know the battle of Badr. After the battle, what happened? They had many, many prisoners. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says to Abu Bakr, he says to Umar, the other companions, his ministers, what do we do with these prisoners? And so Umar radiallahu ta'ala said, separate between the upper portion of their body from the rest of the body. Execute them. And Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala said, no, ya Rasulullah, they are family members, they are people who maybe we show clemency towards them, we show them some mercy, maybe their hearts will become soft towards Islam. Also, there are many family members of ours. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's son-in-law, he was one of the prisoners. Zainab radiallahu ta'ala anha, her husband, was one of the prisoners. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam chose whose opinion? He chose Abu Bakr's opinion and he let them go. Whose opinion did Allah prefer? Allah preferred the opinion of Umar radiallahu ta'ala, as we will see when we talk about Q. Q is for Quran. Certain verses which came down in accordance to Umar radiallahu ta'ala's opinion. C. C is for the compilation of the noble Quran. It was during the time of Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala that Umar came to Abu Bakr and said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, Ya Khalifata Rasulillah, O the one successor of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you need to do something because we have many people coming into Islam. We have many newcomers, many converts, many rebirths, many lands, etc. have been taken over and people are becoming Muslim. And they don't know how to read the Quran. They are messing up things. We don't have one book for people to read the Quran from. During the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we had Sahaba who used to write down the Quran. Other Sahaba used to write down and put their own tafsir on the side. We had some Sahaba who used to record the Quran in the chronological order. So they would have Iqra, Bismi Rabbika alladhi khalaq, as the first revelation. And what's the last revelation? What's the last verse revealed?
Was it Ayatul Dain?
Ayatul Dain, the ayah of death, wasn't the last, it was from amongst the last. It's the longest verse in the Quran in Surah Al-Baqarah. Now, but what's the last verse we mean? The Quran.
Two eyes before that.
Al-Yawma akmaltu lakum deenakum wa akmaltu alaykum ni'mati. No. Jayid. Today I have perfected your religion and chosen for you Islam as your religion. No, wasn't the last. That was revealed in Arafat. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam lived a few months after the Hajj. Jayid. He passed away in the month of? Passed away the month of? Rabi al-Awwal. Hajj is in which month? Dhul-Hijjah. Jayid Dhul-Hijjah. Arafat is on the 9th of Dhul-Hijjah. So then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was still around in the month of Muharram. Muharram is the first month of the Islamic year. Jayid, so Muharram, Safar, and then in Rabi al-Awwal, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away. So about 80-something days, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was still around for after the day of Arafat. The last verse revealed was, واتقوا يوما ترجعون فيه الى الله. جيد. It's either just before ayat 15 or after ayat 15. سوره البقره. واتقوا يوما ترجعون فيه الى الله. سبحان الله. Heavy words. And fear Allah. Have the taqwa of Allah. يوما, for that day. ترجعون, that you will return. إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون. ترجعون, you will return back to Allah. Fear that day when you will return back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That was the last revelation, last verse revealed to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. جيد, we're talking about the compilation of the Quran. So Umar comes, Ya Aba Bakr, join the Quran, put it together in one book. What does Abu Bakr say? How can I do something that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam never did? This would be a bid'ah. This would be an innovation. How can I do this? Eventually he says that my heart was open up to this matter, to this idea. And so he got Zayd ibn Thabit and a few other companions. He says to them that you guys are in this Quran compilation committee and you need to compile the Quran into one book form. And so they did this during the time of Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Whose idea was this? It was Umar radiallahu ta'ala's idea. Excellent. Later on in history, during the time of Uthman, they found that there were more lands, etc., which had been conquered, and they required more copies, etc. So Uthman put together another council. They did a recompilation of the Quran. They compared it with the compilation which was done during the time of Abu Bakr. And that compilation, by the way, after Abu Bakr passed away, then it was with Umar radiallahu ta'ala, it was with him this copy. It was only that one copy around, it was with Umar. And when Umar passed away, who had this copy? Umar's daughter, Hafsa radiallahu ta'ala anha, the wife of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, she was given this task of taking care of it. She was given the task of looking after it. So take note, side story. That Umar had great sons like Abdullah ibn Umar, his famous son Abdullah ibn Umar. But the Quran was not put into the safeguard of Abdullah ibn Umar. Rather, it was given to the daughter of Umar radiallahu ta'ala, Hafsa. She looked after that copy. So the point is, ya Mashayikh, the close relationship that Umar had with the noble Quran, in that number one, he was responsible for the whole compilation of the Quran. Number two, it's his daughter who looked after the original copy. And number three, revelation would come down in accordance to his opinion, as we will see later on, inshallah. Jayyid, D is for what, Ya Mashayikh? D is for Damascus. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give victory to our brothers and sisters. Damascus was taken over. It was a Roman. It was one of the main Roman towns, the city of Damascus. It was a walled city. During the time of Umar radiallahu ta'ala, Khalid ibn Walid and Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah, both of them laid siege to the city of Damascus. And eventually, after about 70 days, the city of Damascus fell to the Muslims. In fact, there's a whole story. Khalid was on one side. It's a massive city, kilometers wide. You have the wall around it. Khalid's on one side, and he manages to get into the city with some soldiers of his. Abu Ubaidah is on the other side. Who's the commander of the Muslims? Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah, not Khalid. Khalid was the commander, and then he was removed. So Abu Ubaidah is on one side. He's negotiating with the people of the city of Damascus. Eventually, they agreed to surrender. And Khalid on the other side, he doesn't know about the surrendering, etc. And he attacks, manages to get in. And so he's attacking and they're fighting from one end. And in terms of fiqh, the fiqh is different when it comes to you take over a city and they surrendered, or if you took over a city by force where you fought, etc. In terms of the war booty, in terms of distribution, etc., the laws are different. So eventually, subhanAllah, what happens? They come to the middle of the city. Khalid ibn Walid is coming from one end, and his sword is dripping with blood. And on the other side, Abu Ubaidah is walking with the high priest, etc. And they just sign a document, you know, with regards to surrendering and the peace document. And so some scholars said what they did was, they divided the city in half. Half of it was taken by force, and half of it was taken by peace. E for equality, Ya Mashayikh. This is something that Umar radiallahu ta'ala was known for. During his time, subhanAllah, you had Amr bin As radiallahu ta'ala. Who was Amr bin As? He was the governor of Egypt. He was the conqueror of Egypt. He was someone, subhanAllah, who was an enemy of Islam. And then he became Muslim, and like 2 months later, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam puts him in charge of an expedition that As-Salasil. So I'm not being asked things now, subhanAllah, you know, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam puts me in charge, and under me is Umar, under me is this companion, that companion. Probably the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam loves me the most. That's why he put me in charge. So Amr bin As comes in public there in Medina and Munawwara, and he says, Ya Rasulullah, man ahabba an-nas ilayk? Who is the most beloved person to you? In public, Jayid, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Aisha. And he says, no, I'm not talking about that love, I'm talking about, like, you know, from amongst the men. Side story, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in that super conservative society, in that society where they were burning daughters alive, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had no qualms about saying that he loves his wife, loves Aisha, the most. And then he asked, and then who? Her father, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. And he still went through Aisha. He meant, obviously, Abu Bakr, her father. And Amr bin As says, okay, and then who? And then Umar. And then who? This one. And then who? That one. And this one. And that. Then he realized, you know, Jazakallah khair, you know, maybe my name is not on the top 10 there. Assalamu alaikum wa alaikum salam. And he left. Point is, look at the leadership quality of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He actually made Amr bin As, who's a Muslim for only 2 months. Imagine, he thinks that he's actually complete. He actually feels that he's on a better footing than Abu Bakr, who's been Muslim for all of those years. But that's how the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made him feel, subhanAllah. And so, technically, he, like, you know, had the audacity to come forward. He thought, but technically, we might have been a bit embarrassed, subhanAllah. So Amr bin As, when he was the governor of Egypt, his son had a race with someone, and his son lost the race. And then his son beat up the guy, because, well, I'm the governor's son, and I lost, etc. So beat the guy up. This guy goes to Umar radiallahu anhu, and Umar's justice was known to all. This man complained to Umar during the time of Hajj, etc. I was there in Egypt. Amr bin As's son, I had a race with him. He beat me. I beat him, and then he physically beat me up, etc. Umar summons both of them, father and son. He asks the son, is it true, etc. Talking about the adl, equality of Umar radiallahu anhu. Here's the governor and his son, and here's an ordinary layman. Umar radiallahu ta'ala ascertains that yes, this man is guilty. So he says to this guy, I want you to hit him. I want you to hit the son as he hit you. Bisos, like you did to me will be done to you. Someone walks around and just slaps you. You take him to court. Eventually, if the guy's found guilty, what's the punishment? You would snap him back. Jayid, someone stabs you. Someone cuts off your finger. Bisos, an eye for an eye, a hand for a hand. The same would be done to that person, if you want that. Or you can choose the blood money, or you can choose just to forgive the person. So this guy was beaten up. Then Umar says to this guy, now you beat up the father, do the same to the father. So man says, but subhanAllah, you know, the father didn't do anything, it's the son who did this. So Umar radiallahu ta'ala said words of wisdom, words that should be written with gold. Umar said to the father and the son, مُذْ كَمْ تَعَبَّدْتُمُ النَّاسِ وَقَدْ وَلَدَتْهُمْ أُمَّهَاتُهُمْ أَحْرَارًا. Since when you treat these people as though they are slaves, when their mothers gave birth to them as free men. They are free men, and you people, you the governor, and this is your son, etc. And you treat people like this, as though they are slaves? Impossible, cannot happen, and especially when I'm in charge. Another time, you had one of these kings of the Ghassasina tribes. He became Muslim, Jabhala. He comes to Makkah al-Mukarramah in all of his pomp and fashion and his robe, etc. And he's making tawaf around the Kaaba. Take note, many a person just became Muslim because the Muslims were the dominant force now. Because the Muslims were, you know, in vogue. Because Islam was in vogue. Because they are the powerhouse. So this tribe here, this king, he became Muslim. He comes there and he's making tawaf. And one old guy was making tawaf behind him and mistakenly stepped on his robe. So the guy almost tripped. He turned around this king and he slapped this guy. And so this man goes to Umar and complains that I was making tawaf in front of the Kaaba, and this is what the man did. So Umar radiallahu anhu summons that king of the Ghassasina tribe and asks him, is this true? The man says yes. And he says that had it not been for the Kaaba in front of me, I would have made a better example of this individual. What does he think? He's a suqa, you know, just a lowly person. So Umar says that, okay, so you're guilty, khalas, you snap him as he slapped you. So this king says, what craziness is this? What nonsense is this? I thought if I become a Muslim, I'm going to have greater honor in Islam than what I had. I'm the king, etc. I'll have more honor in Islam. Allah says, no, you've got your honor, but this is the rule here. You stab the man, you are guilty, all of you are equal in this matter. So the man says, well, if that's the case, I mean, I don't want this religion, I go back to my old ways. Umar says, well, then it's not going to be a stab, but rather separate between the upper portion of the body and the rest of your body. And the man says, Jay, give me a few days to think about the matter. And so what happened? This king of the Ghassassina, during that night, he escaped and he left Makkah al-Mukarramah, Allah mustan. Side story, this comes to mind. This river became Muslim, subhanAllah. And, there was an overzealous brother who was dealing with him. So the guy says to him, you know what, now you became Muslim, the first thing you need to do is, halal meat, that's the most important matter. And number two, you need to circumcise yourself. Jayid. So these two matters you need to sort out as soon as possible. So this guy is like 34 years old, he read about Islam, etc. And now he became Muslim. Now the circumcision thing was a bit tough for him, Jayid. It wasn't going down too well with him. So he says, don't circumcise yourself, you're not Muslim, Jayid. In fact, the Jews, the Christians, the Jews, etc., they also circumcise themselves, and you have to circumcise and eat halal meat. Excellent. Jayid. So the guy says, well, if that's the case, this religion is not going to work out for me, I'm going back to my old ways. The guy said, no, technically, if that happens, then you have to separate between the upper portion of your body from the rest of your body. The guy says, what is this, subhanAllah? Number one, it's all about meat. Number two, if you become Muslim, it's about chop chop. Number three, you leave Islam, it's also chop chop. Everything is chop chop in there. Allah mustan. Hayyakumullah. Jayid. So that was Umar radiallahu ta'ala with regards to his adl. And that's why when one of these emissaries, one of the messengers of either the Persian Empire or the Roman Empire, when they came to Umar, they wanted to visit, talk to him, meet with him, give him a letter, etc. They asked around, where's he? So someone said, well, he's not in his house, maybe he's in the masjid. So they go to the masjid there, and they see he's not there. Outside somewhere, they find Umar lying down, he's asleep, he's got his small pillow, he's got some blanket, something, and he's fast asleep, nicely enjoying himself. So the guy comes there, and he says, subhanAllah, where's the man's palace? Where's the man's guards? Where's, this guy is controlling Iraq, and controlling this place and that place. Where's all of his pomp and passion? So this messenger said, Hakamta. فَعَدِلْتَ فَأَمِنْتَ فَنِمْتَ. You judged, حَكَمْتَ, you judged. فَعَدِلْتَ, and you were equal in your judgment. You had equality in your judgment. فَأَمِنْتَ, so you had safety. فَنِمْتَ, and so you were able to sleep like how you sleep. Right? Many a time the ruler or whoever he might be, he's got this large hashia around him, large number of people around him. Why? Bodyguards, etc., etc. Why? Protection from the people that he's supposedly ruling over. Allahu musta'an. Jayyid. There was E, which was the equality of Umar radiallahu ta'ala an. F, for the family of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Ahlul Bayt. Close relationship between Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, etc., and the Ahlul Bayt. Number one, Umar radiallahu ta'ala an, when he would travel, like when he went to Jerusalem. You remember when you went to Jerusalem, they said that we will only surrender the city to your leader. This is not like any other city. This is Al-Quds. We will surrender it to your leader. He must come and take the key of the city. So Umar went all the way. And you remember, he was there with his animal, and then he was crossing some water or some river, etc. He rolled up his trousers and he crossed. He had these patches on his garment. And then one of the Sahaba, Abu Ubaidah, comes to him and says, Amir al-Mu'mineen, these people, you're going to meet with the high priest of Jerusalem, you're going to meet with the Jews, the Christians, etc. Maybe wear something else, maybe wear something better, more appropriate. What did he do? He gave him a punch in his chest, and he said that, if only I had heard these words from someone else, I never thought that I'd hear these words from you. And words of wisdom, subhanAllah. He said, we were a qawm. We were a people, we were a nation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us izzah through Islam. فَمَهْمَا طَلَبْنَا الْعِزَّةِ فِي غَيْرِهِ أَذَلَّنَا اللَّهِ. And for as long as we sought izzah, honor, dignity in other than Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will debase us and Allah will disgrace us. We were people who were lowly, Allah gave us honor through Islam. For as long as we seek that honor in other than Islam, Allah will disgrace us. Allah Musta'an. And when he said we were all, I mean generally or more specifically, he was talking about the Arabs. And how many times you find, and this is not 100% rule, but many a times you find the subhanAllah, whether you go to Australia, whether you go to many places where many of our Arab brothers, etc., have settled, many a times you find that people from the Indian subcontinent, etc., wherever it might be, you know, they go to a country, they make sure that someone goes and studies, someone becomes a Molana, someone comes from the Indian subcontinent to teach the kids to recite the Quran, etc., etc. So whatever deen they have, you know, they keep it going, build a masjid, build this, do that, you know, start a madrasa, alhamdulillah, all things are going. And so they kept on, you know, quite strongly to their religion, whatever little bits broken here and there, whatever they had with their cultural baggage, but they kept it going and the kids continued, alhamdulillah, those who moved to the West. Whereas many a times with our Arab brothers and sisters, when they went to some of the countries of the West, etc., you know, the first generation, so they got busy, but they always had this idea, we're going to go back to our country, we're going to go back to Lebanon, we're going to go back to this country, you know, we're not staying here. What happened then? You know, the kids came along, and then we're all going to go back, you know, we're not staying here. So there was no, you know, thinking about their tarbiyah, you know, an Islamic school, a madrasa, a masjid, a this, a that. And then one generation, two generations, subhanAllah, you know, they slipped much faster than that guy from India or Pakistan or Bangladesh, etc. So when they slipped faster. But the opposite is also true, that when that Indian guy or the Pakistani guy or Bangladeshi guy wanted to rise up and he wanted to go up and he was memorizing and he was trying this or that or fi sabilillah or whatever, he tried to rise up, he rose, alhamdulillah. But when an Arab corrected himself and he rose, he shot up also faster than everyone else. Allahu a'lam, that's what some have said. I personally, in my short life, have experienced that myself. When the Arab went up, he went up faster than anyone else. You couldn't meet up, you couldn't beat that guy. But when he fell, he also fell faster than anyone else. Allahu musta'an, jayid. You have, for example, Abdul Rahman As-Sumait, this individual who started Africa Muslim Agency, which is a humanitarian organization. This guy, subhanAllah, from Kuwait, he would live for months, like about 11 months of the year, you know, in the middle of the bush in Africa, doing da'wah left, right, and center, living with the people, staying with them in their huts, in their tents, etc. Even our brothers from Jamaat al-Tabligh, they might come, they might stay there for a few days, and then they'd go, but this guy would stay there for months on end. He spent almost his entire life doing that, and how much of progress he made in da'wah. Then came September 11th and broke much of that progress, Allahu musta'an. F was for the family of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Jayid. So Ali radiallahu ta'ala, he gets one of his daughters married to Umar. Kulthum, the daughter of Umar, gets the daughter of Ali, gets married to who? Gets married to Umar. And so this dispels, you know, these type of statements, etc., that many of the Shias think that Umar is like from amongst the worst of people, Abu Bakr from amongst the worst of people, etc. Here is Ali, he names one of his sons Umar, he names one of his sons Abu Bakr, he names one of his sons Uthman. If he hated these people, why would he name his kids after them? Number two, he gets his daughter. Ali is the father-in-law of Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Ali gets one of his daughters, Kulthum, married to Umar. Ali gets one of his daughters, Kulthum, gets married to Umar radiallahu ta'ala. Also, Umar, you know, he started off this stipend system every month, because not a lot of money was coming into Muslim state by that time. You remember during the time of Abu Bakr, people were, when it came to zakah, there were certain individuals who were not paying zakah. You think by the time of Umar, you think everyone was paying zakah on time? Everybody was paying zakah on time. Okay? They learned the lesson earlier on with Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala. So money was coming in, and Umar radiallahu ta'ala set out the stipend system. The Ahl al-Bayt, people of Badr, people who fought in Badr, they would all get these various amounts. And Hassan and Hussein were looked after very, very well by Umar. He would give preference to Hassan and Hussein even over his own son, Abdullah ibn Umar. Hayyakum Allah. Jayyid, G for what, Ya Mashayikh? G was for the guarantee of paradise. He walked this earth and he had the guarantee of paradise. But still he would come to Hudhayfa radiallahu ta'ala and he'd ask Hudhayfa, that is my name from amongst the munafiqeen, is my name on that list, because Hudhayfa knew who the munafiqeen were, Hudhayfa knew who the hypocrites were, is my name there? He was never complacent, subhanAllah, Jayid. And so, Ya Mashayikh, what about ourselves? Name might be Muhammad, name might be Suleiman. You know, we might, read some Quran, we might do this good, etc. But never be complacent. As the hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, maybe a person is a hand span away from paradise, ends up somewhere else. Maybe a person is a hand span away from the hellfire, and he enters into paradise. So you have friends, you have people, you might think, well, subhanAllah, this person here, you know, look at their end, look at their situation, but you never know. And at the end of the day, when everything is said and done, you know, it is our hearts which count. إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. That يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالُ وَلَا بَنُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. On that day when nobody's wealth and health and this and that will be able to help them, except the one who comes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with a heart which is pure. As has been said, every highest person has a past, every righteous person has a past, and every sinner has a future. Umar was a person who lived the life of Jahiliyyah, consumption of alcohol and doing this. He would actually hit some of the Muslims. He was torturing the Muslims. He was a person beating the slave from Banu Mu'ammil, hitting her and hitting her and hitting her, until eventually he stopped hitting her and he says to her, leave Islam, leave Islam. And he says to her, I'm not stopping because out of mercy or something, rather my hand's paining, now that's why I'm stopping. Jayin. He would beat these people who were Muslims. They never thought that he'd ever embrace Islam. And some of them would say that Umar's father's donkey would become a Muslim first, even before Umar radiallahu ta'ala. But subhanAllah, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala changed his heart, and how we sit here today with you half asleep, and we talk about Umar radiallahu ta'ala. Now, Jayyid. H is for Hudaybiyyah. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam accepted all of those conditions, that number one, anyone becomes Muslim, they must not be allowed to go to Medina al-Munawwara. They become Muslim in Mecca, they must be forced to stay in Mecca, where they'll be tortured, where they'll go through torment. That's the rule, that's what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam accepted. Also, if someone comes to Medina and he renegades upon Islam, he leaves Islam, he must be allowed to go to Mecca. Also, you can't make the Umrah this year. You must go back to Medina and come next year and make Umrah. Every condition, it seemed to go against the Muslims. So Umar says, Ya Rasulullah, how can we accept this disgrace? Are we not upon the Haqq? Are they not upon Batil? Are we not Muslims? Are they not Kuffar, etc.? Prophet ﷺ said, yes, 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 but this is the order of Allah, and I will not disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Umar radiallahu ta'ala, he took ready, he really thought that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would be able to be convinced. He did this for the sake of Islam. I mean, some interpret this, our brothers from the Shia, etc. So look at Umar. You look at how, look at his audacity, etc. Look at how his, arrogance, etc. No, absolutely not. Rather, subhanAllah, he did this because he wanted benefit for Islam. He thought that he could, twist the arm of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Maybe Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would give in. Ya Rasulullah, you only came here to make the Umrah. You only want good, you only want khair. How can they prevent us, etc. And then Umar would say that I continue to set slaves free. I continue to give charity, etc. Why? Because of my stand on that day. I didn't really understand what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was saying. What was it all about? Later on, when Allah sent the revelation that this was a victory for the Muslims, then I understood, subhanAllah, this was victory. It also made peace between the Meccans and the Muslims. So now people could talk about Islam. Prophet ﷺ could send the letters to the various tribes, to the various rulers, etc., and tell them about Islam. So it was a victory in reality. Hayyakum Allah. I is for what? I is for Islam. We already spoke about this. He embraced Islam at the age of 27. What was the story about his embrace to Islam? You all know the famous story. What was it? Amen?
He came across his sister reciting the Quran.
Jayid, his sister Fatima, she was in the house and her husband's name was? Sa'id ibn Zayd. Jayid, Sa'id ibn Zayd. So they were reciting the Quran, someone was teaching them, etc. Umar barges in eventually, and then he hits his sister and he sits on Sa'id ibn Zayd. And then he asks, okay, what were you reading? And then what verses were those? طه ما أنزلنا عليك القرآن لتشقى إلا تذكرة لمن يخشى تنزيلا ممن خلق الأرض والسماوات العلى الرحمن على العرش استوى جيد. And few more verses. So he recites this and then he says, is this what the Quraysh are running away from? Is this what they deny? The one who says such words only has the right to be worshipped. دلني على محمد. Show me where Muhammad is, etc. And we know that he left his house on that day to do what? To kill the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Subhanallah. يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبنا على طاعتك. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would make dua. Oh, the turner of hearts, make my heart firm upon your religion. Okay, look at how Allah turned the heart of Umar radiallahu ta'ala. Want to kill the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, at the end of the day becomes Muslim, walhamdulillah. This story about him embracing Islam, etc. It's a famous story narrated in the Musnad of Imam Ahmed. It has some weakness in it. For example, in the story it goes that his sister said to him that no, you can't touch this scroll or whatever, you need to go, you know, and take wudu or take a ghusl, etc. And so he went into ghusl and then he came back. Now, if you're not a Muslim and you took a ghusl, how's that really going to help you? Doesn't really help you. Number two, in touching of the Quran, you can take 10 ghusls, won't really help you. Number two, in the desert there now, you think he's going to go and take a full ghusl head to toe, as if this is the burden for you. Now for him to leave there, go take a ghusl and come back, another half an hour, 1 hour job, Allahu A'lam. Narration has some weakness in it. Jayyid. Jahiliyyah. J is for Jahiliyyah. Umar radiallahu ta'ala during the times of Jahiliyyah. Another story about his embrace of Islam was that one night he was looking for some alcohol, looking for some drink here. Maybe the bar was closed, Allahu A'lam. So he goes to the Haram of Makkah and he's seated there. And then he looks, he finds Muhammad comes into the Haram and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is making salah. So what does he do? He goes, you know, where the curtain of the Kaaba is, and he stands there and he blocks himself with the curtain. And he hears the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam reciting verses. That's this Quran. And so Umar says, this is the words of a kahin. These are the words of like a soothsayer. Wala bi qawli kahin. And Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam recites the verses of Quran. Wala bi qawli kahin. And these are not the words of a kahin. Then he says, well, this guy is like a poet. Wala. And then Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam recites the verses. Wala bi qawli sha'ir. And they are not the verses of a sha'ir, of a poet, etc. And so this, you know, was like the seed which was planted in his heart, and then soon after he became a Muslim. He was also in the days of Jahiliyyah an ambassador for the Quraysh. He was also a person who was a wrestler. He was someone from amongst the few who learned to read and learned to write. As we said, when he became a Muslim, he says that, you know, that he really lived the life of Jahiliyyah. And whoever doesn't understand Jahiliyyah will not appreciate Islam. He said that the bonds of Islam, the knots of Islam will be undone one by one. When there lives in Islam, those who do not appreciate Jahiliyyah, those who do not really understand where we're coming from. You know, subhanAllah, how many times we have a friend, you know, he's become Muslim. Look at how many of the du'at, how many of the callers to Islam, many of them formerly were not Muslims. Abdul Rahim Green, Bilal Phillips, and many others, Hamza Georges, etc. You know, they lived the life of Jahiliyyah, they lived the life of Kufr. We sometimes, we sit and say, you guys are enjoying yourselves. Now you come and you make Salah all day, Tahajjud, etc. Now you already had a nice time, leave us alone now. But they understood that Kufr, that there was nothing in that Kufr, that there was no joy in it, subhanAllah. Jayid. And so that's why, you know, they appreciate Islam maybe more than we appreciate Islam. We were given that silver spoon in our mouths, and so we don't really appreciate it, Allahu A'lam. There's another famous story, emotional story with regards to Umar in the days of Jahiliyyah, that he had his daughter, and his daughter was young, and the people came to him and says to him, oh Umar, I mean, you've got a daughter now, I mean, obviously, you know the rule, you need to bury your daughter alive. And so he says, no, just now, she's 2 weeks, 2 months, 3 months now, and she's almost 1 year. They keep on coming to him, pressure is mounting, and now she's 2 years, and he's delayed the matter, pressure is mounting, until eventually he can't take it any longer, social pressure. He takes the daughter and he goes outside Makkah al-Mukarramah, and she asks, Daddy, where are we going? Are we going to play a game, etc.? And he takes her there, and he starts digging up this hole. And so she joins him, and she's also digging with him, and they go together, father and daughter, and Umar radiallahu ta'ala, tears are rolling down his face, rolling down his cheeks, And he continues digging, and she's also digging. And then he tells her, okay, you stand here, and she stands there. And she and himself, they start putting the soil onto her feet. And it gets more and more until it reaches her knees. And then he increases, and she also thinks it's a game. And we're having fun, like the beach, etc. And so put more sand. It reaches her chest. She's finding it a bit difficult to breathe. But she continues, you know, he continues. Until subhanAllah, Umar radiallahu ta'ala, as per the story, he buries his daughter alive. Many of you heard the story? Many of you heard the story before?
Yes.
Huh?
Yes.
No, the story is not true. Okay, the story is false. Okay. You should be happy. That seems so sad. No, it should be true. Right? No, for the story is false. Okay. Number one, Umar radiallahu ta'ala did not have daughters. He had daughters, Hafsa radiallahu ta'ala anha, who married the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He had daughters. Why didn't he bury them? That's number one. Number two, this practice of burying daughters was not the practice of the Arabs of Makkah or Hijaz. This was, yes, a practice of Arabs, but it was not so much the practice of the Arabs of Hijaz. We had the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had Fatima, we had Umar had daughters, Abu Bakr had daughters, etc. And none of them did this to any of their daughters. So, hayyakum Allah. Jayyid, K is for what, Abu Shaykh? K is for Kalb. Kalb is what? Kalb is a dog. That's what Umar radiallahu ta'ala screamed out when he was attacked in the masjid during Salatul Fajr by Abu Lu'lu'a al-Majusi. Akalani al-Kalb. The dog has bitten me. Dog has eaten me. Jayyid. Abu Lu'lu'a al-Majusi, the fire worshipper, plotted, planned. The story goes that he came to Umar and was complaining about his master, Mughira ibn Shu'bah. He says, my master does this and doesn't cheat me and do this and that, etc., overburdening me. So Umar's way was, he says, you just look after your master and you be good to your master. And then Umar went to the master and said, you know what, your slave is complaining, etc. But when he said this to Abu Lu'lu'a, Abu Lu'lu'a was like, when your justice is open to everyone and not me, why are you telling me this? I'm complaining about him and you're reprimanding me. So he harbored this enmity. That's one version. Second version is that there was some insider movement by the Persians, etc., to get rid of Umar radiallahu ta'ala anh, because the Muslims were at war with the Persians at the time. Nonetheless, whatever it was, he enters the masjid during Salatul Fajr, Umar radiallahu ta'ala anh in Salah, and he attacks Umar radiallahu ta'ala anh. And he also attacks about 13 other of the companions in the masjid, and 7 of them lost their lives. And what did he then do? Then he killed himself, Allah musta'an. Later, when Umar was taken to his house, when he came around, they told him about Salah, subhanAllah. Imagine, even in that state, he prayed his Salatul Fajr after he had gone to the house. He's called Shaheed al-Mihrab, the martyr of the Mihrab. And imagine this, Ya Mashaykh, that when he was stabbed, the front row, Abdul Rahman ibn Auf, I think it is, that stepped forward and took over the Salah and completed the Salah. Then here, Amir al-Mu'mineen, leader of the believers, is stabbed, assassinated in Salah. But Salah has to be finished. Salah can't be made half of. We have to finish the Salah, then we take care of him, etc. And when he was taken to his house, when he came around, what did he say? Yes, they told him about Salah, he says, yes. There's no shame in Islam for the one who doesn't pray, subhanAllah. And they gave him something to drink, and then he came out of his body, came out of the intestines, etc. They realized that there's no hope in this matter, that the doctor cannot help him in this matter, there's no shifa from this matter. And so when he asked, who was the one responsible for this attack upon me? He was told, Abu Lu'lu'a al-Majusi. He praised Allah, that at least it was not someone who bowed down to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. At least it was not someone who maybe he had an issue with, etc., from amongst the Muslims. And that was Abu Lu'lu'a. And in a certain country, they built a massive, you know, building, etc., massive karamat or mazar or mausoleum, etc., in remembrance of this killer of Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Allah musta'an. Abu Lu'lu'a, it says there, Baba Shuja'uddin, the brave one, the wali, etc. Allah musta'an. And his body wasn't even taken to that country. His body, he killed himself, and his body was probably gotten rid of in Medina al-Munawwara. Al is for what, Ya Mashaykh? Al is for? Love. Ibrahim says love. Now, subhanAllah. Al is for love. Excellent. You saw Amr bin As, coming to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who do you love most? Well, number one was Aisha, number two Abu Bakr, number three was Umar radiallahu ta'ala. Also, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he was with Umar radiallahu ta'ala, Umar says to him, Ya Rasulullah, you know, I love you more than anyone, anything, except myself. I love you the most, Ya Rasulullah. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says to him, technically, you know what, Umar, you don't really have true belief until I'm more beloved to you than even yourself. So after some time, then Umar radiallahu ta'ala came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and says to him, you know what, Ya Rasulullah, you're more beloved to me now than even myself. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Al-an ya Umar, now you truly believe, subhanAllah. Ya Mashaykh, where are we from that? Where are we? Million miles, Allah musta'an. He narrates 539 ahadith from the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. M is for migration. Umar migrated from Mecca al-Mukarramah to Medina al-Munawwara. Two famous stories with regards to his migration. One is the famous one, the more nice one, the more beautiful one, the one which ties in with his character. That supposedly Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, when he wanted to migrate, he went to the Kaaba, he made tawaf around the Kaaba 7 times. He took his bow and arrow, etc. He saw some of the Quraysh cronies sitting there. He came to them, he says, whoever from amongst you wants his wife to be widowed, wants his children to be yatim, meet me on the other side of the mountain because I'm going to Medina al-Munawwara and I'll sort him out there. Right? And obviously nobody wanted to meet Umar on the other side of the mountain. That story ties in with his character, although the second story is the more authentic one, and this is the one where Umar, Ayash and Hisham, three friends, they decide to leave Makkah al-Mukarramah in the darkness of the night, and then they left, and then one of them, he was caught and he returned back to Makkah, and the other one, the Quraysh, pursued them until when they were almost into Medina al-Munawwara, they caught up with them, and they said to Umar, and they said to the other guy, that either was Hisham or Ayash. He says, you know what, your mother took an oath. She's not going to comb her hair. She's going to stand in the sun until you come back. Just come back and talk to her, meet her, and then, you know, she can break that oath. And then you can come back. I mean, we're not interested in you. And so Umar says to him, don't go. It's tricking you. Don't go. I'll give you money. I'll give you this. The man says, no, my mother. And he returned with them. And eventually he was tested, he was put to trial, they captured him, and they beat him up, and they tortured him. Allah musta'an. Later on, when the verses of the Qur'an came down, that لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ Do not lose hope in the mercy of Allah. Imagine Umar, years later, but he remembered his friend who was put to trial. So don't lose hope in the mercy of Allah. When this revelation came down, Umar wrote it down and sent it to that friend in Makkah. And when he read it, he realized, you know what, there's still hope for me, alhamdulillah. And then he migrated back to Medina al-Munawwara. Because in those days, Ya Mashaykh, it was a sign of your iman that you migrated. You had to migrate. It wasn't an optional matter. You had to migrate. It was a sign that you are Muslim, that you migrated. Yalla, Ya Mashaykh, before you almost fall asleep, N is for name. The name of Umar was Umar. That was his ism. His name was Umar ibn al-Khattab. And his kunya was Abu Hafs. His kunya, his agnomen was Abu Hafs, father of Hafs. Although he didn't have any son by the name of Hafs. He had a daughter, yes, Hafsa. Hafs means lion, right? So he was, you know, his kunya, father of the lion. Although he didn't have any kids by the name of Hafs. And you don't need to have a kid to have a kunya. What's your kunya, Ibrahim?
I haven't chosen.
Are you orphan?
No.
Choose a kunya. What name do you like? You married?
No.
Okay, when you get married, when you have a kid, what name will you be given? What name do you like? Abdurrahman. So from today you are Abu Abdurrahman. Right? Abu Abdurrahman. Right? That's your kunya. Imam al-Nawawi said it's mustahab, recommended whether you have kids or don't have kids, for you to sit one day and choose a kunya. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he saw that small boy, Umair, he had that bird nightingale which died. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, Ya Aba Umair, ma fa'al al-Nughair, O the father of Umair, what has happened to your bird? Okay, look at how the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam dealt with this small boy. His bird died, playing like, you know, rhyming with him. O the father of Umair, what happened to your Nughair? Point of proof is, he called him father of Umair. Did that small boy, 6 years old, have kids? No, even at that time, wasn't. So, he called him father of Umair. Also, Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said, Ya Rasulullah, all your wives, they got kids, you know, they are Habiba, Salama, etc. I got no kids. What's my kunya? So Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to her, your sister has a son by the name of Abdullah, and the mother's sister is like a mother, so you are Abdullah, you are the mother of Abdullah. She had no kids. Abu Huraira, father of the cats. He would play with his kittens all the time, and so he was called father of the kittens, father of the cats. Abu Bakr had no son by the name of Bakr. Bakr means a young, agile camel. He had no son by that name, but he was called Abu Bakr. So sit today and choose a kunya, inshallah. His name was Umar. He's laughing. That's a joke. Laughing joke. Jayid. What's your name, you told? Salman. What's your kunya? What are you studying? Medicine.
No, radiation.
Jayid, excellent. So what's your kunya?
Abu X-ray.
Abu?
X-ray.
That's a bit too see-through, Chef. A bit too transparent. Abu something. Abu what? Abu Muzammil. Abu Muzammil. Jay, so today you go home, inshallah, you tell your mother that from today, inshallah, I am Salman, but I'm also Abu Muzammil. You know what she can say? SubhanAllah, what's this radiation doing to you? Split personality, breaking out. What's going on? Allah, tell them it's fine, inshallah. And his laqab, his title was Al-Faruq. Al-Faruq meaning the criterion, the divider between haq and batil. So you have a name, you have a kunya, and then you have a nickname or a laqab. Jayyid. O is for? O is for ordering the good and forbidding the evil. Umar radiallahu ta'ala. During his time, the grave of Danyal, as the Ahlul Kitab say, was a prophet. So his grave was exposed, Jayyid. And so they wrote to Umar, you know what, this grave has been exposed. What do we do? People saying that this is the grave of Danyal, a prophet, etc. So Umar wrote back and he says that, I want you people to dig up 13 graves during the day and then bury the body in one of those graves during the night and cover up all. Why? So that the people don't know where the grave is. Dig up 13 during the day, one here, one there, one there, one there, one there. And at night, bury him and cover up all. So people don't know where the grave is. Why? So that he doesn't become a fitna for the people. People don't go there and start asking him from the grave and doing this and doing that and all of those things. Jayyid. Umar didn't think of it like some people think, whoa, subhanAllah, we got the grave of the Nabi. You know, we can ask him and he can help us out, etc., etc. No. Umar's understanding was this could be a fitna for the people. Also, Umar, during his time, people were gathering at Hudaybiyah under that tree where the Prophet ﷺ had taken the Pledge of Allegiance from the Sahaba, Bay'at al-Ridwan. They thought Uthman was killed, so they took that Pledge of Allegiance. People were going to the tree, maybe sitting there, maybe making salah, etc. What did Umar do? He chopped down the tree. Right? Why? Because it's a fitna now. Why people gathering there? Nothing special about the tree. Just so happened it was a hot day, so we sat under the tree for shade. Doesn't mean that there's anything special about the tree. Right? No. And then once, you know, like fitna like this is given time to breathe, what happens, subhanAllah? Sometimes later, you find one individual taking that leaf off the tree there, and then he keeps it under his pillow, and someone else is starting to sell, you know, the leaves of the tree. One guy is selling roots of the tree. Once they know you specially swat from that tree, your teeth will get weak, etc. People come up with all these things. You see in the haram, subhanAllah, you know, where the jannat will, what do you call it, subhanAllah? The Rawda, right? In the Haram of Medina, where the Rawda is, Rawda min Riyad al-Jannah, garden from amongst the gardens of paradise. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, between his mimbar and his house is that portion of earth which would be a garden of paradise. Excellent. So the carpet there, subhanAllah, is a different color carpet from the rest of the carpets in the haram. So you find a brother there, you know, nobody's watching, so he's trying to take fruit threads of that carpet, you know, to take back to his country, etc., you know, blessed thread. Where did the carpet come from? From China, subhanAllah. All the haram door, etc., the guy wants to rub the door, etc. Where did the door come from? The door came from China. They in Allah. Check it. People, what they child? Peaceful parents. Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, his father was Khattab ibn Nufayl, and his mother was Hantama bint Hisham. Whether they became Muslims or not, Allahu a'lam, we don't have too much of information with regards to his parents. Q is for what, Ya Mashayikh? is for Quran. Give me some examples, ya akhawat, sisters. Jayd, alhamdulillahi alladhi ahyana ba'da ma amatana wa ilayhi nushur. Now, Jayd, you all awake now? So, give me some examples of revelation which came down in accordance to Umar's opinion. Anyone? Sisters? Fadal fi akhlaq. Hijab, Jayid. He says, Ya Rasulullah, you know what, I mean, your wives, people meet them, people see them, this and that. But you know what, I don't think this is most appropriate. And after he talked about this, the verses of hijab came down for the wives of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, or according to other scholars, general for all Muslim women. Jayid, what else? Something else? Omar's opinion. We talked about the prisoners, yes or no? Battle of Badr, Allah sent down revelation in accordance to the opinion of Umar radiallahu ta'ala. Jayid, third one. وَاتَّخِذُوا مِن مَقَامِ إِبْرَاهِيمَ مُصَلَّى. He says, Ya Rasulullah, this maqam Ibrahim here, where Ibrahim had stood, that stone, etc. By the way, side note, you know, the actual footprint of Ibrahim alayhi salam, is still around today? No, it's not around. It's been long gone, right? For centuries. Jayid, what you see there, you know, is that metal, what do you call it? That metal casing, Jayid, the metal casing which is shaped, you know, like, 2 feet. Yes or no? When Jayid, underneath that, you know, is the rock, right? But originally the rock actually had, you know, the footprints. But in through history, because everybody was touching, you know, it's, you know, it's been like, what do you call it? Smoothed down, right? It's been smoothed down. And so we just have that rock there, but you have the casing on top, which indicates where the footprint was. Also, the black stone. I think I'm giving you more sad news than anything else, right? That story was false. The black stone, right? I mean, you have the casket, you have the casing outside. When you put your head in there, with that cloud, etc., I mean, what's the black stone? The black stone is only about 8 small stones inside there, which are the black stone. So there's like, you know, there's like stone, or there's like some sort of resin, and then those 8 stones, or cement or something, and those 8 stones are, you know, like cemented into it. Fahimto? So subhanAllah, you know, you might go for Hajj, take you 3 hours from the back of the haram there to push your way, you know, to get there to the black stone, and you might put your head inside and still miss it. Say it, Allah Mustafa. Eight small stones. Allah Mustafa. Jayid. And because why? Because in history people tried to break it, people tried to steal the stones. Jayid. You have the whole black stone. History, Ya Mashaykh. The sect of the Qaramita, they came to the Haram of Mecca and they killed hundreds and hundreds of Hujjaj in one of the years. And they took the black stone and went back to wherever they came from. For about 20 plus years, the black stone wasn't even there in the Haram of Mecca. It was wherever the Qaramita were. And that's why the Fuqaha during that time, you know, like if there was a faqih there in Mecca, he's writing about Hajj. So he says, and then, you know, you point to the place where the black stone used to be. Because it's not there any longer, subhanAllah. And later on, it was brought back. Yalla, what else? Prohibition with regards to alcohol. We know that Umar would make dua, Ya Allah, you know, send us a final ruling on this matter of alcohol. Because Allah first said, you know, there's good in it, bad outweighs the good. Okay, number two, when it's time for salah, don't come drunk. And later on, then the prohibition came, it is rizq, it is filthy, it's whatever, stay away from it completely. Side note, from the time the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam became a prophet in the year 40, Jayid, when he was at the age of 40, 13 years he was doing da'wah in Mecca, and then he went to Medina al-Munawwara. It was about another 3 years or 4 years or something that alcohol was still allowed for people to consume. So technically about 15 years in Islam, you know, alcohol was still halal. Yes or no? Yes, subhanAllah, Jayid. Tadarruj, step by step. You remember we talked about our overzealous brother about the circumcision matter? Doesn't mean now you can tell the guy you consume alcohol, but the point is, look at the Sharia, how it came down step by step, slowly, because giving someone everything in one day, it's impossible for them to take it all in, for them to digest everything in. Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha says, if the first revelation was, stay away from alcohol, stay away from this and that, people wouldn't have believed. Rather, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had to build up their iman, build up their faith, talk about accountability, hisab, yawm al-qiyamah, standing before Allah, iman, faith, all of these things, iman, yaqeen, etc. Once that was nice and strong, then give them whatever you want, they'll accept. Yes or no? Sometimes, remember, I said in Bukhari, we attended 1,000 courses, the guy who even talks at the course himself, the sheikh, the mulana, whoever it might be, they are the ones who are the, you know, the leaders in sin. They are the ones who are first hand in sin. And they are the ones drowning in sin. Allah understand. Why? Because of that iman, that yaqeen, that tarbiyah, that ikhlas, that purity of the heart, etc. If that's not there, then whatever, you know, icing, and if the, you know, the core is corrupt, you can put as much foundation and as much, you know, spice and as much outer covering, etc. But it's not going to change anything. But if the core is pure, if the core is correct, then the rest of it will be correct, inshallah. Jayyid. What else? Prohibition of alcohol, the prisoners. We spoke about hijab. We spoke about Maqam Ibrahim. So, Ya Rasulullah, why don't you pray behind Maqam Ibrahim? Two rakahs of salah. Allah sent down revelation. That's what you should do. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the Muslims. After we make tawaf, we pray two rakahs of salah behind Maqam Ibrahim. And another important one, Ya Mashaykh, was salah over the munafiqeen. Salah over the munafiqeen. Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul, the head of the munafiqeen, the head of the hypocrites, the one who spread the lies about Aisha that she committed zina, etc. The one who took away one third of the army at Uhud. He says, no, I don't think there's going to be any fighting. Come, my friend, let's go back to Medina. No fighting, let's go back. One third, he took the army away. He would enter the masjid, he would say to the people, he come late, right? And he said to me, listen to what I meant. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is giving the khutbah. This man walks in late, but he wants to put on a show. Yeah, listen to him. What he's saying is very important. Yeah, listen. SubhanAllah, makes a mockery. This man here passes away. Who prays janazah over him? Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam comes there to pray janazah. Because outwardly the man claimed he was a Muslim. We judge him upon his outward behavior. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam knew he is a munafiq 100%. But we judge by apparent. Umar stands there, Ya Rasulullah, how can you pray over this man? He said this and he did this and he did this and he did that. Prophet smiled. He says, Umar, akhir anni, move away from me. I have been given a choice and I have chosen. What choice? Allah said in the Quran, if the Prophet seeks forgiveness for the munafiqeen, or he doesn't seek forgiveness for them, even if he seeks forgiveness for them 70 times, Allah will not accept it. So Prophet is like saying that maybe if I seek forgiveness for this head of munafiqeen 71 times, maybe Allah will accept. SubhanAllah. Look at Nabiul Rahmah. Look at the Prophet of Mercy. Head of munafiqeen, maybe if I do it 71, maybe then Allah will accept. Jayid? So he prayed janazah. And what was the man's kafan? The man's kafan was the shirt of the Prophet, vest of the Prophet. His son came, Ya Rasulullah, my father said that when he dies, I must ask you for your shirt to be used as his kafan. Prophet ﷺ gave it. But where's this person? Fi darki al-asfali min al-nar, in the lowest pits of the hellfire. Revelation came down in accordance to Umar's opinion. وَلَا تُصَلِّ عَلَى أَحَدٍ مِّنْهُمْ مَاتَ أَبَدًا وَلَا تَقُمْ عَلَى قَبْرِ. Do not pray over any of these munafiqeen. No stand over there. No stand over their graves. So various matters, revelation came in accordance to his opinion. R is for what, Ya Mashaykh? R is for responsibility. He was the Amir al-Mu'mineen. He was the head of the Muslims. And he really took care with regards to his citizens. When he came to Umar before being the caliph, you know, we have much of this, you know, this stern side of Umar. When he became the caliph, subhanAllah, many a times you see a very soft and concerning side of Umar. Like, for example, this female came and she was complaining about her old husband. She says, no, my husband is like this, and husband is like that, and he does this, and he does that, etc. So Umar found it a bit strange. We know the husband to be a very nice man, very good man, righteous man, etc., etc. So Umar summoned him and asked him, you know, what's this, your wife's complaining about you, etc., etc., you're doing this, that. He says, no, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, you know, my wife, she has the best of this, she has the best of that, she has the best of this, you know, I've given her everything, but, you know, she's much younger than me, and now technically, you know, I'm reaching old age, etc., so in certain departments, you know, things are difficult, etc., etc., and that's why she's complaining. So Umar radiallahu ta'ala said to her, you enemy to yourself, you ate up his youth, you ate up his wealth, you ate up all of this year, and now you want to complain? Gave them some material, and they both held hands, and they lived happily ever after. Jayid. Another man comes out, ya Amirul Mu'mineen, I want to divorce my wife. Why do you want to divorce your wife? He says, no, because I don't love her. Jayid. So Umar radiallahu ta'ala said to him, our kullu buyut buniyat ala al-hub fa'ina ri'aya. Is every house built upon love? Where is responsibility? Where is the care? Where is the concern? Yes, maybe you're married to her, whatever. Now it's 10, 20 years, etc. The love's gone out of the window, whatever happened, whatever, etc. But where's the responsibility? She's given you 4 kids and she's been there presiding, she's provided for you and this and that and all of these things for all of these years, all of the service. Where's the responsibility now? Just divorce and khalas, she's gone and you marry someone else? No. Is every house built upon love? No, not every house is built upon love. Where's the responsibility, the service, the giving back, etc.? So Umar reminded him about that. Also, Umar radiallahu ta'ala, when he came to Ubay ibn Ka'b, this was a companion who would recite the Quran very beautifully, etc. Umar put him in charge of Salatul Taraweeh. So Umar comes to one of these towns and he finds Ubay there. And because Ubay was like a, you know, was a person of honor, etc., companion. Wherever he'd go, you know, there'd be a whole bunch of people behind him. He goes right, all these people behind him. Goes left, people behind him, etc. All the time they're behind him. Umar radiallahu ta'ala reprimanded him and the people. Umar said that this type of behavior, wherever you go, people behind you, you know, like this follower and leader all the time, he said this is disgraceful for the followers and it's a fitna for the person being followed. Jayid. It's fitna for the person being followed. Why? Because he thinks nobody like me. No, I'm the best man here. Nobody like me. I'm the super leader, etc. I sit, khalas, there's a chair. I stand up, they're ready to put my shoes on, etc. It's a fitna. And also it's disgraceful for people following. Why? Because this man's a human being. He goes to the toilet. Why are you following him all the time? Right? He's a man like you people. Jayyid. Also another man comes there and Umar finds he's got a massive belly. Not that the man was born big or something, but he's complacent, eating left, right, and center. So Umar says, Ma hada, what is this? The man says, no, this is, you know, barakah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Barakah, mashallah. Umar says, no, this is adab from Allah. This is punishment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not barakah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And now they individually found him, you know, he's like super humility, super khushu, you know, when he walks, when he talks, lowers his head, you know, he's very soft in everything, very quiet in everything, walks like, you know, back arch also. Umar gave him a few shots, Umar would carry this durra with him all the time, give a few shots, etc. They don't kill our religion. Walk like a man, don't kill our religion. Your taqwa is not in the way that you walk, your taqwa is in the heart. Jayyid. Also, Umar, you guys at university, Umar radiallahu ta'ala, when he would come across someone, you know, he found this handsome man, etc., handsome youngster, etc. So he'd ask about this guy, whether he's got any sort of skill, whether he's got some sort of profession, etc., that he can earn a living by. And if it was said to Umar that, no, this guy doesn't really have anything, so Umar would say that this guy is now dropped in my eyesight. In the level of honor, etc., I thought, you know, nice, handsome guy, etc. Yeah, but he's got a profession, excellent, mashallah, good. He's got a skill, excellent. He's got nothing, so he drops in Umar's eyes. What was time? S is for what, ya Mashaykh? S is for? S for Shaytan, Iblis, Jayid. Iblis would be afraid when he would see Umar radiallahu ta'ala on the street. What's the story? Story goes that the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam were all seated and they wanted an increase in their allowance. So they were asking for more money, Jayid. So the story is old from those days. Excellent. So then, the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so they seated there, they want more money, etc. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is talking to them. And then, you know, they were like raising their voices. And Umar was passing by, he knocked on the door. And so they all kept quiet and they all covered themselves up, etc. And so Umar entered, he sees the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam laughing. And so he says, Adhakallahu sinnak, you know, may Allah always keep you smiling, Ya Rasulullah. You know, what happened? Prophet said, because of them, you know, just now they were all raising their voices, they wanted money, wanted this, etc. And then they heard you, and they all shut all of them quiet. So the Umar says, oh, you enemies to yourselves, I mean, you're more afraid of me, and you're worried about me, etc. And you're not worried about the Prophet, you raise your voice for him. And so one of them said, yes, because he's soft, etc., and you're very, very harsh. And so the Prophet says to Umar, don't worry about them. Even Iblis, when he sees you on the street, he even turns away. Even Iblis, when he sees you, Now he's given the freedom of 100 times that are Allah Mustaan. Jayyid. T is for what, ya Mashaykh? T is for Taraweeh. Umar radiallahu ta'ala was the one who reinstated Salat al Taraweeh. It's not like how our brothers of the Shia say that Taraweeh is a bid'ah of Umar and there's no such thing as Taraweeh, but rather we state that Taraweeh is the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He prayed it for about 3 nights or 4 nights. He either prayed it for 2 nights, didn't come out on the 3rd night, or he prayed it for 3 nights, didn't come out on the 4th night. What was the reason? He felt that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would love this action so much, Allah would make it an obligation upon the ummah. Now that the Prophet passed away, is there any fear that it could become an obligation? No fear. And the Prophet did give us indications that it would be re-implemented in the ummah when he said that the one who prays the 9th prayer in the month of Ramadan with Iman and hoping for reward will have his sins forgiven. The one who prays with the Imam the 9th prayer in the month of Ramadan until the Imam finishes will get the reward of praying the entire night, etc., etc. So Umar reinstituted this practice of Salat al-Taraweeh in one jama'ah, large congregation behind one Imam. And U is for what, Ya Shaykh? We said S-T-U. U is for Uhud, the Battle of Uhud. Who was the leader of the Mushrikeen in the Battle of Uhud? Father of Jayyid, yes. But who was the main leader? Abu Sufyan. Jayyid. In the Battle of Badr, it was Abu Jahl. And Abu Jahl, the upper portion of his body was separated from the rest of his body. Jayyid. And then at Uhud, we had Abu Sufyan, the father of Muawiyah. He later on became Muslim. Abu Sufyan became Muslim and Muawiyah became Muslim. Nonetheless, in the Battle of Uhud, we know the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and then they suffered over 70 were martyred. Hamza was martyred. Mus'ab ibn Umair was martyred. Khalid ibn Ikrimah attacked the Muslims from the rear, etc. The archers came down. You all know the story. Excellent. Point is, at the end of the battle, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was holed up on one section of the mountain with Abu Bakr, Umar, etc. On the other side was Abu Sufyan. He screamed out, "Is Muhammad amongst you?" Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Don't respond, because if we respond, you know, they might know where we are, number one, etc." And then he asked, "Is Abu Bakr amongst you?" And then Prophet said, "Be quiet, don't respond." "Is Umar amongst you?" "Don't respond." And then he screams out and he says, Abu Sufyan screams out and says, "Ah, we've killed Muhammad, we've killed Abu Bakr, we've killed Umar, we've killed all of them, you know, we're victorious." So Umar couldn't manage any longer. He screamed out, he said, "Oh, you enemy, Prophet Muhammad is amongst us, and Abu Bakr is amongst us, and Umar is here, etc. Jayyid, and you know, you haven't killed him or anything like that." So Abu Sufyan screams out and says, "You know what? You know, I believe you, you know, you're more truthful than even Ibn Qami'ah, the one who claimed that he killed the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam." Because Mus'ab ibn Umair, that youngster from amongst the Sahaba, the one who lived a very luxurious life in Makkah, and the one who, when he passed away, subhanAllah, they didn't even have a kafan to cover his entire body. He resembled the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam a lot, and that's why when he was killed, they thought that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was killed. Ahimtum? Nonetheless, so Umar screamed out, and then the Prophet ﷺ told Umar, oh, then Abu Sufyan screamed out, "Fu'ilu Hubal," glory be to Hubal, and you know, esteemed be Hubal, etc. So Umar said, "Ya Rasulullah, what must I say?" Prophet ﷺ said, "You scream out, Allahu A'la wa Ajal, Allah is higher and Allah is more magnificent and more jalal, etc. to Allah." And then this one screamed, Lat and Uzza are their protectors. So Umar screamed out after the Prophet said to him, "You say, Allahu Mawlana, wa la Mawla lakum. Allah is our protector, and you people have no protector." That was at Uhud. Jayyid. V is for what, Ya Mashaykh? V is for? V is for, we'll be finishing very, very soon. W is for? W is for what, Ya Mashaykh? W is for wives. W is for wives, wives of Umar radiallahu ta'ala. In total, he had 7 wives. Famous wives, number one, Kulthum, the wife of Umar, who was the daughter of Ali radiallahu ta'ala. He also had another wife by the name of Atika, and she was the one who was in the masjid when Umar was attacked. Atika, she was in the masjid. And in fact, Umar would prefer that his wives made their salah in their houses. So Atika would say to him, "Are you preventing me from going to the masjid?" He says, no, I can't prevent you from going to the masjid. He says, well, for as long as you can't prevent me, I'll continue going to the masjid. And she continued going, and she was in the masjid when he was attacked. Some have stated, and this is untrue, this is not true, some have stated that Umar radiallahu ta'ala banned women from the masjid. Absolutely not. In fact, if he ever did such an action, side note, those who dislike him, those who look for anything to pick on Umar, etc., like Shia, they would have used this as ammunition number one, and says, look, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, do not prevent women from coming to the masjid. And what did Umar do? No, I'll prevent women from the masjid. They say that this would be an example of Umar totally disregarding the words of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Umar never did that. His wife was in the masjid when he was attacked. In fact, his son in Sahih Muslim, Abdullah ibn Umar, his son Abdullah ibn Umar having a conversation with his son, Bilal. So Bilal said that, my women, my family, I'm not going to allow them to go to the masjid. So Umar's son, Abdullah ibn Umar said, I told you that the Prophet said, do not prevent women from the masjid. And you're telling me you're not going to allow them in the masjid? Wallahi, I'm not going to talk to you. That was the son of Umar to his own son in Sahih Muslim. So he had 7 wives in total, not all at the same time, obviously. X is for what, Ya Mashayikh? X is for?
Abu X-ray.
X is for X-ray. X is for? Anyone? Because I don't have anything. X is for? X is for? Almost exiting. Why is for what, Shaykh? Why is for you? Why is for you people? Shaykh? This is Umar radiallahu ta'ala. He lived a life of 60 years. He started his legacy at 27 as a Muslim. He left behind a legacy that today we sit here and we talk. He was a man who had the guarantee of paradise, but still he was not complacent. Still, subhanAllah, he feared hypocrisy for himself. He feared nifaq for himself. Look at the trials and the tribulations that he underwent after he became a Muslim. Left Makkah al-Mukarramah, left his wealth, left everything, and he journeys to Medina al-Munawwara. Look at how people never thought that he could become a Muslim. How many a person, subhanAllah, you might think, what, no chance for this person. This person is so far away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but never ever, ever lose hope. And for yourself also, never ever lose hope. Yes, we'll fall, we'll slip, we'll wake up again. كُلُّ بَنِي آدَمَ خَطَاءَ وَخَيْرُ خَطَائِينَ التَّوَّابُونَ Every single one of the children of Adam, they fall into error. Who's ma'soom here? Anyone here is perfect? Nobody's perfect, subhanAllah. Look at Ma'iz, radiallahu ta'ala, and his companion. He fell into the crime of zina. He fell into the error of zina. He comes, Ya Rasulullah, you know what? I've fallen into zina. Prophet ﷺ turns away from him. He says, Ya Rasulullah, I committed zina, Ya Rasulullah. He could have kept quiet. Prophet ﷺ said to him, you know, Allah will forgive you, Allah forgive you, make tawbah, Allah will forgive you. But he wanted purification. Ya Rasulullah, he testified 4 times against himself. Then obviously the penalty was applied upon him. Prophet ﷺ told them, take him and have him stoned to death. That's what he wanted. And so he was stoned to death. Later on, subhanAllah, and imagine, you might say, I mean, what did Ma'is see? You know, I mean, in comparison to the fitna that we live in, left, right, and center, billboards, this, that, whatever, mushkila problems, yes or no? Ma'is, what, maybe a fingernail, maybe someone's eyelash or something? Jayid, what was the temptation in comparison to our time? But he fell into the error, Allah musta'an. He wasn't ma'soom, he's a companion living in Medina al-Munawwara, subhanAllah, amongst the best of generations. After this was done, after he was stoned, Prophet ﷺ heard 2 people talking about Ma'is, the sins of the tongue, sins of the tongue. Talking about Ma'is, they said, look at Ma'is, he died like a dog. He came and out in public and he publicized his sin, and now he's died like a dog. Prophet ﷺ heard this and said to both of them, you see the dead carcass that camel lying there for a couple of days? Both of you go and eat from that carcass. Ya Rasulullah, that smelly, stinking carcass, how can we ever eat? Nobody will ever eat from that. A'udhu billah. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that your speaking about ma'iz is worse than both of you eating from that carcass. And verily, ma'iz right now, he's swimming in the rivers of paradise. SubhanAllah. Jayin, the sins of the tongue, Allah musta'an. So why, ya mashayikh, is for you people. That what are we doing? What is my life? What am I doing? Where do I stand with regards to myself and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What have I put forward? What have I done? Where am I with regards to my parents? Where am I with regards to my friends? Where am I with regards to my people around me? Where am I with regards to people who are suffering, our brothers and sisters being slaughtered every single day in Syria? Well, lastly, I lift up my hands and make dua for them. Have I taken out $1 or something and given in charity? Our brothers and sisters in Burma, have I done something? The speaker, even before those being spoken to, Jayid, we first, even before everyone else. Allahu musta'an. Lastly, Shaykh, Z is for dhikr. Umar radiallahu ta'ala would say that the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is the Aisha radiallahu ta'ala, as she would say that the dhikr of Umar radiallahu ta'ala, the remembrance of Umar radiallahu ta'ala, it perfumes the majalis, it perfumes the place where you are in. Talking about him, the beauty of Umar, the good times of Umar, the virtues of Umar, the fadail of Umar, the equality, the adl of Umar radiallahu ta'ala. These are examples, Jayid, these are our fathers. And also Umar would say that the mention of men is a sickness. Hoping for the dhikr of men, hoping that people talk about you, etc. Jayid, that day is like an illness, that day is a sickness, riya, etc. Whereas the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that is the cure. Hayyakum Allah, jazakum Allah khairan. That was A to Z, a short A to Z, inshaAllah, with regards to Umar radiallahu ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you all for sitting in this gathering. Most of this which was mentioned, you already knew, walhamdulillah. But khair, walhamdulillah, at least we sat together. It was this majlis which was perfumed by the mention of Umar radiallahu ta'ala. May Allah reward our sitting here in our scales of good deeds. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unite us with Umar radiallahu ta'ala in Jannatul Firdaws with the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Jazakum Allah khairan. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.